Welcome, friends. My name is Alex. We are here for another very intense episode about something serious. We are here today at the Surf Shack in Carolina Beach. This is a serious topic, but it's gonna be a fun video. I am at a small little Airbnb on the coastline, and a buddy of mine, that's all he does, is he buys these little things, been doing it for a couple years, buys these little shacks up and on the coastline. Turns out Carolina Beach rents for like $500 a night. I wanna buy one of these, so I came down here. He wants to know how to do video, and he called the best person he knows how to do video, and they didn't answer, so he called me next. We're gonna talk about how to do Airbnbs, and I'm gonna put him on camera to let him tell his story so you can learn how to do it too, because he's not the only one doing it. You could do this too. I'm gonna do it, and you could do it too. Let's go meet him right now.
I'm Clint Harris.
And you live in?
Carolina Beach, just outside of Wilmington, North Carolina.
And where we are right now?
We're staying in one of our multifamily Airbnb short-term rental properties.
This plot is two properties?
Yep, it sure is. So this is, it's a upstairs, downstairs duplex up front, and then it's got this small cottage on the back that's 16 by 20 feet.
This is where I just stayed last night. This used to be a shed.
It was a shed. When we got it, it was four walls. The roof was kind of falling in and it was a dirt floor. Long story short, we arbitraged the property. We took out a master lease.
Mm-hmm. You rented it from him and then re-rented it to Airbnb.
Right, and he put some money into it. He spent the $9,000 to fix this up. He spent another $10,000 fixing up the upstairs and sprucing it up a little bit. At the end of a 2-year lease, I'd like to have first right of refusal to buy it. If you decide you want to sell it, I'll give you a maximized rental history, and now all of a sudden your property's not overpriced at $570, it's underpriced because we're going to do really well with the rents.
Did you buy it?
Yeah, we since then bought it with owner financing. But that first year we did $125,000 in gross rents with a net of around $54,000 after all expenses.
What'd you end up paying for the property?
At that point in time when we got that net, the only thing I had into the property was $4.99. We continue to go up in rent. So to date right now on this property, and we're what, last day of August? And we're at $124,000. But that upstairs unit is a 2-bed, 2-bath. It's a really great unit that does a little over $50,000 a year. The downstairs unit was also a 2-bed, 2-bath. But what we've found is that there's such a shortage of small-term rental properties here that we split that downstairs unit, I'll show it to you, and now it's, instead of a 2-bed, 2-bath, it's a 1-1 and a 1-1 with two separate kitchenettes, and those are worth $40,000 a piece. And the mortgage is already
paid. Can we go see all three of them? All the three units right there?
Yeah.
Can you go see all of them?
Yeah.
Let's go check it out.
We can see two out of the three. One of them's got somebody in it still, but yeah, let's go.
Let's go.
Basically interest-free credit cards to pay for all the staging, so we didn't have to pay any interest on that. And then we talked the owner into 3 months of delayed payments on the month. He deferred the payments for 3 months. We got this unit up and running, that back unit up and running. By the end of the second month, we had paid back the 3 months of deferred rent, so we were a month ahead, and we paid back the all the financing as well for the furniture. So this is a 2-bed, 2-bath unit. The owner came in and put new floors in. We put a mini split system in. He had just a hole in the wall cut right here that was just a window unit. It needed a little bit more light, so we put that light in. We reran a little bit of electrical and just put some pendant lights. The symmetrical photography works really, really well. So we...
Don't tell me how to do a job, Clint. How many of these do you own?
14. 14 units that we own and 54 that we manage.
So how many buildings is that?
It's three quadplexes and a duplex. We started getting involved with different real estate investing podcasts and stuff like that. We moved here in 2017, looked around for a year. We flipped houses in the past. We'd done some long terms and did some accidental burr properties because I'm an idiot. Got a few of them right, got a few of them wrong. And then when we moved here, we started hearing about short-term rentals and started really researching it. You're rating the guests are rating the property. So anytime it's on a rating system, the good's gonna rise to the top, right? And so if you're in the middle of the pack, you're either rising or falling. You're never gonna stay still. The question for me was, what's the highest and best use of every dollar that I have to invest? It's gonna give me the greatest return on money. And what we figured out is that it's gonna be small multifamily properties. There's very little competition in that space in this market. So for me, it was 2 to 4 units, 1 to 3 bedrooms each. The larger the property, you'd think that the more money you can make. And even though the average daily rate goes up, the occupancy goes down. The sweet spot for us was to land in the middle where those smaller groups are nimble in the market. Our first winter, November through February, we were booked 71% of the time in our smaller units. So even though my average daily rate comes down, the occupancy is still there, and that means reviews. Most people start off in this game chasing revenue, and that's a mistake. I think you need to chase reviews, because reviews give you the option to crank up and leverage. Like, I've got properties that started a year ago identical to the properties basically next door. We started off about the same, and then rolling into the winter, I drop my rates down, I keep farming those reviews. Rolling into the next season, they're still the same two properties, but I can charge $150 to $175 more per night because I've got a significant more number of reviews than they do, and I'm higher up on the list.
You're higher up on the list, and that's really what you're fighting for. Not the dollar, but longevity, which means staying up on that list, which means good reviews, right. Super host.
Pre-COVID, this time of year, we average 900 to 1100 clicks on each one of our listings per month, so call it 1,000 people. Since COVID happened, we're averaging 4,500 clicks per listing. We're booking at all-time high average daily rate. When COVID happened, we shut down for March and April of last year. I had $30,000 in bookings canceled in a 12-hour period. As soon as we opened back up, we just hunkered down and left them empty. It was fine. We wanted to keep everybody safe. As soon as we opened back up, it was off to the races. And we caught up on the year by the second week of October, where we wanted to be, and we ended the year at an all-time high by about 30%. Because of that positive negative feedback loop that we talked about, you become your own data source. The more listings you have, you become your own data source, and you just listen to the market. What the market used to ask us was, how close is it to the beach? Do you have beach chairs? Is it pet friendly? All of a sudden, that market is asking us, how good your internet connection? Is there a workstation? Can my kid do school remotely? Can my husband and I work remotely? Our average length of stay jumped from 3.6 days to 6.6 days. So we listened to the market, and very quickly, we used to have reading nooks and coffee stations and stuff like that. We ripped a lot of them out, and we put in workstations with chargers and lamps. And then on some of the smaller properties that didn't have them, we put in washers and dryers.
My buddy Neil, I lived in Las Vegas with my good buddy Neil, and he goes, I don't want to live in Las Vegas anymore. I'm getting rid of my job. I'm going to move to Carolina Beach. I'm going to hang out with Joe Prilliman, who I made. Everything he knows, I taught him.
Hey guys, I'm Joe Prilliman. I don't know what I'm doing.
And he buys his house on Red Street.
Yep.
Now I want to do it. How can I do it? How can somebody else do it?
The key thing that you're looking for, if you're looking for a house hack like Neil got, beautiful four-bed, four-bath house, ocean view from three different levels, but there's an opportunity to change the unit density. The downstairs is basically a separate mother-in-law suite that can easily be closed off legally according to HOA and everything like that. It's got a side entrance. The key here is unit density. And understanding that you're gonna start a little slow, especially if you're hosting it yourself, and you've gotta build up those reviews and build that reputation. But again, if you don't start off chasing revenue and you start off farming reviews, you'll be able to leverage that very quickly and get to the point where, like, where my wife and I found ourselves in our first situation is getting paid to live at the beach.
That's amazing.
Yeah, it's a beautiful thing.
This one's lovely.
Thank you.
This is coming out good.
It wasn't 2 weeks ago. Yeah, tile wasn't in yesterday when I came in. So I just stopped by and this had a horrible popcorn ceilings, bad floors. So we put some tongue and groove on the ceiling.
And this is good looking, but this is not I don't mean to be rude. This is not a fancy upgrade.
No.
These are nice cabinets. And it's nice tile, but that's shiplap.
Yep.
And that's formica.
Right. Listen, it's a one bedroom, one bath place at the beach. Like, what do you want? I mean, I can make it as nice as you want it, but we make it nice enough that this is gonna do 45 grand.
Yeah, I'm saying how attainable this seems.
Right. You know, we had a broken stove in that upstairs unit that you were just in for 2 months before we ever were able to get a replacement and get it in there, and nobody wants to try to use it. People come to the beach, they spend an average of about 4 hours inside the property, and especially smaller properties like this. If it's a family property and they got two or three big families in a six bedroom place, they're gonna cook dinner a couple times, right? They're gonna order pizza in, and then they're gonna cook and stuff like that, and they're gonna cook breakfast every morning. Smaller units like that, people are coming here to experience the town. So they're gonna go get breakfast, they're gonna go eat, they're gonna go to the tiki bar, they're gonna go get lunch other places. This is all you need. This one is our first unit on this property that doesn't even have a stove. It's gonna have a cooktop, and it'll probably still be wrapped in plastic wrapped 2 months later.
Advice for somebody who wants to start Airbnb.
So if you want to get started in Airbnb, the most beautiful thing I would say is that it is free to educate yourself these days. There are so many resources online in terms of podcasts, articles, anything that you want to read about. And so, like, even if you don't have any money, when we got started with we bought our first property, but after that, we were out of money. We didn't have any. And that's where we figured out what I've since learned is called arbitrage. We didn't know what it was called at the time. But people will put their trust in your ability to operate. So even if you have no experience, you have no money, you can't get started. What you can do is reach out to local Airbnb or short-term rental hosting groups, jump on with somebody as a co-host for free, just to help them out with their messaging, learn their system, do it for free. And then you're building a portfolio that you can go to a property owner like this one or someplace else and be like, look, I'm a co-host on some top producing super host Airbnb properties. Here's a look at the portfolio that I help operate. I think that your property has a lot of potential. I'd like to come in there and take a master lease on your property and use the arbitrage model. I don't love the arbitrage space, but it was the fastest way for me to make an extra $100,000 that we could turn around and invest.
Somebody who doesn't have an Airbnb, doesn't have resources, can still go out there and both make money and learn the business.
Yeah, but by learning from other people's experience and using a data-driven perspective where we can use other hosts' past performance to dictate our ability to have future success here, that's what generated the revenue that we can turn around and put to work.
Easy.
Sure.
I really wanted to end this video at the island, but I forgot to do an outro. So I'm here to tell you that Clint, I had to cut his video by about 40 minutes because that dude can talk, but he's actually incredibly smart. I know he doesn't seem like it. If you want to learn short-term rentals, that is the guy to learn from. Chase reviews, not income. That's what I'm trying to do. Not doing a good job yet, but we're going to get better. That's the dude to learn from, Clint Harris on Carolina Beach. And I want to say thank you for watching all the way to the end. And I know that this format of this video has been different than the last two. I'm still feeling out my style, trying to find out what people like. Let me know in the comments which ones you like. You like this video, you like the other style. I'm going to do a little bit of both no matter what. But I'm learning some new software. And because you waited all the way to the end, and I know that nobody waits all the way to the end, I'm going to show you a little trick that I learned with Adobe After Effects. I can do really tricky stuff like this.
Because I'm an idiot. Because I'm an idiot. Because I'm an idiot. Because I'm an idiot.
That's dangerous.